Once again, good evening to everybody. So very happy to have you all in this forum together. So today we will all be learning about how to upcycle plastic. So Garima Upreeti, she is a research scholar at University of Lucknow. So she is currently doing her research in environmental science. Apart from being a researcher, she is a very enthusiastic environmental lover. So she is very fond of reusing all those plastics and stuffs which fall as or which create a negative impact to the planet. So she tries to reuse everything that is found around her. So you can find her on Instagram, and she has made a lot of interesting stuffs out of things which we throw into dustbins. So we mindfully throw into dustbins knowing that they will create an impact on environment, but some they do not know. So this stays as a bridge to connect people together. And please try doing this at your home. So all the plastics which we have, especially all those plastic PET bottles at home, they can be reused and they can be upcycled in a much beautiful manner. So thank you, Garima, for joining us today. Now the forum is yours.
Thank you. Namaskar, everyone. Am I audible?
Yes, Garima, you're audible.
So, namaskar, everyone. This is Garima, and today, as she told you earlier, that we will be learning about plastic waste and its management. And since I do my experiment with upcycling this plastic waste and reusing it, so I will be showing you some of my items also, right? And we will be having two short activities also, and then in the end we will be having discussion, right? So basically, when we think of plastic waste, generally a picture of a dump site or a landfill comes to our mind. And during this lockdown period, when the whole environment was getting better, the air quality was getting better, the rivers were getting clean, I had this in mind that this is not possible that the plastic waste would also get reduced, you know. Even if we humans would have been inside our home for a long decade also, then also the plastic waste would have been same as it was earlier. Because it's really tough that a plastic which is once generated or which is once brought into this world, it will go back or it will get degraded completely in at least 10, 20, 100 or even 500 years. So now during this COVID situation, this pandemic situation, we have one more problem, and that is the problem of, you know, an improper disposal of this plastic mask. And these masks are now becoming a new issue for us. They have started clogging the drains, rivers, the birds and animals and marine life especially. They are getting affected. And this all points towards the management of waste, how it can be and how it should be managed properly. This is a pandemic time, and we have to use this, you know, protective equipment. We cannot just rely on some jugaad based idea. So we have to use it, no doubt. But since we are using these equipment at a large number, on daily basis we are using million of masks and million of these gloves all over the world. Hence, it's our responsibility to dispose it, you know, responsibly. There are guidelines for the disposal of these waste, and especially for plastic waste, there are guidelines and rules. But the problem lies in the implementation and awareness part. For example, I'm sure most of us, even in this, you know, in the audience also, most of us might not be aware of the plastic waste management rules, which had arrived on 18th March in 2016. So this whole set has rules and regulation and how the waste should be managed at home, at municipal corporation site, and at any other industrial area or everywhere. Similarly, there is a point, responsibility of waste generator in these rules. It completely and it clearly states that it is the responsibility of producer, that is you and me. It's our responsibility to segregate the waste which we produce at the source itself and try to minimize it as much as possible before sending it to the collector, the person who collects the waste from our home, from our offices, or from some other place. So these have to be implemented properly. Like most of us aren't aware about these rules, right? When I myself came to know about these rules late in 2018, I came to know about these rules, and then I started segregating my waste at home itself. Right now I'm living in a hostel, so I follow this rule over here also. Whenever I generate my waste, I try to segregate it. Why segregation is important? See, in India we are producing a lot of waste per day. Okay, I will be telling about that on later on. So when a manpower is invested on segregation itself, a lot of time is invested on that. Okay, instead of doing that, if the segregation starts at the source itself, it will save a lot of time and manpower, and then it becomes responsibility of the producer. It becomes a responsibility of me and you that we have to segregate it. Similarly, there are three main reasons why plastic is emerging as a problem. The first one is its lifetime. The lifetime of plastic, as I earlier stated, that it is from 10 years to 500 years, and even more than 500 years. So suppose a plastic is brought into this world, most of the time a plastic spent is in a dumping site or landfill, or most probably in an ocean bed. The second reason is plastic production, amount of plastic produced. See, it has been only 100 years since the plastic was produced, and we have already accumulated 9 billion metric ton of waste. 9 billion is a huge amount. If you actually want to imagine how much 9 billion metric ton waste look like, then you can imagine 80 million blue whales all together at a place. Imagine 80 million blue whales in a single place. That much plastic waste we have already accumulated. Or you can even imagine 18,400 Burj Khalifas, you know, that big structure, all together in a place. Okay, let us make it a little romantic. Imagine Eiffel Tower, not thousand, but lakh, 8 lakh Eiffel Tower all together. That much plastic waste we have generated in just 100 years. Now you can imagine the situation which will be coming in, you know, few years ahead. And as per studies, it has also been found that per capita plastic consumption will also rise by 2022. Right now it's 11 kg per person, but by 2022 it will increase to 20 kg. And third reason, which I also find, is unnecessary plastic items. See, once you will try to, you know, identify some of the important plastic items which you need in your life, like laptop, mobile phones, or maybe a headphone if you are working on computer all the time. This is necessary, this we should have. But there are certain unnecessary plastic items which we do not need in our lifestyle, that we can easily give up on, right? That we can easily shift with some eco-alternative. So these are the three main reasons which I find they are causing plastic as a problem. And as I told earlier, that India is producing a large amount of trash. Per day, we produce around 1.5 million metric ton of trash per day for India. It's the India's waste production rate. And this rate is enough to accumulate again a Burj Khalifa tall building. And in the next slide, you will be seeing all our tall dump sites or landfill sites. And these all are famous dump sites of India. The one you can see in the left corner is Ghazipur Delhi site. Earlier it was said that this site was at height of Qutub Minar, of height of Qutub Minar. And in coming few years, it is said that it will reach up to the height of Taj Mahal in Agra. You see, the waste is continuously increasing year and year. Similarly, in Mumbai Devnar site, The site was in news because of 2016 fire. This site has actually caught fire on 2nd of Feb of 2016, and the smoke has you know spread all over the Mumbai during that time. Then you can see as a dumping site, a landfill site in Bangalore. In Bangalore, actually, there was two landfill sites which were known as these other sites in India. The Mandavilipura, this is the Mallavipura and Mandur. The Mandur landfill site, actually, that site was prohibited from dumping because of people of that village. Yes, the people of that village came forward, and then they protested against the dumping of waste in that area. And then on 2014, on 1st December, the dumping was prohibited on that site. But see, the waste generation, using of plastic is one thing, but in the manner the waste is managed, that's the problem. When the segregation doesn't happen at first place effectively, you know, people also get confused, because when you will see further in this workshop, you will see it's quite tough to segregate some kind of plastic. Then they have waste. Now Ladakh is also a landfill site in India. So here I want to, this all picture I'm showing just because if we get enough consciousness about the choices we are making, like if I'm traveling, can I be conscious enough to choose some items or certain items which I won't be throwing on the road? Or if someone have a habit of, okay, I have to throw something out of, you know, on road while I'm traveling, then at least let it be not a plastic item, let it be something which can degrade easily. Or first of all, we shouldn't be doing this, but it's really tough for certain people, you know, they cannot get this habit of eco-traveling or being an eco-friendly traveler. So they have this habit from since long time, so they cannot easily shift for this. So you can be conscious enough to make choices. Because see, the plastic which is generated, 40% of that plastic is used only for packaging purpose, not only for our online shopping packaging, but also for like food packaging, beverages packaging, or chips, etc., all kind of packaging. So 40% is directly for our packaging purpose. So if someone goes without a packaged food, he won't be contributing, or he won't be utilizing that plastic, right? And all of that waste which is produced or which is brought to the municipal dumping site, only 9% is recyclable. Now imagine a whole truck of plastic, whole truck of plastic waste comes to the municipal site, and from that truck, only 9% is recyclable. And 12% is sent to the burning or incineration purpose, right? The whole plastic, 12% will be burnt in that site only, at that particular site only. And the rest, 79%, will go to the landfill. Imagine India producing 1.5 million metric ton trash every day. And from that trash, 79% is going to the landfill every day. So now you can imagine how these high landfills have been, you know, emerged in India in these 100 years, right? So similarly, now this all plastic, when either in landfill or in ocean, now they are impacting not only fauna, flora, but also human beings. For example, in 2015, there was a study that 90% of seabirds, they have been eating plastic. It was a report of 2015. And in 2018, a whale was found dead on beach. You must have heard about that. 32 kg of plastic waste was found from its stomach. What was the plastic waste? Nothing. Nets, plastic bottles. You know, generally when someone goes to a beach and the other all things we carry with us, that all waste was inside its stomach. And this one, the one you can see on your screen, this is the latest report on plastic pollution, how many birds die from plastic pollution. The result you can see, 1 million a year. Around whole, like the research was done for whole of the world. The field area was the whole world. So from whole of the world, 1 million birds every year. You can imagine how this is disturbing the biodiversity of our earth. And this year in 2020, on 5th June, on World Environment Day, we had observed the day as Biodiversity Day, because there is a need to prevent this biodiversity from getting extinct. We know this chain of food web and food chain, right? How we all are interlinked with each other, how a small species is responsible for many larger action, which we won't be able to understand unless we look into that insight or unless we look at that perspective. So now this plastic from the dump site or from the landfill, it reaches to ocean through many sources, right? And one of the source is rivers. 90% of waste which reaches the rivers is from only 10 rivers of Africa and Asia. Only two continents with their 10 rivers contribute around 90% of waste which goes into the ocean. And among these 10 rivers, most of are of China and the rest are of India and Africa. The Yangtze River of China, it contributes the maximum 1.5 billion ton. And Ganga from Bharatvarsha, that is India, contributes 1.2 billion pound. It is less in comparison with China, but it is huge when you see the land area, right? If we see the land area, then this contribution is really huge. So now this plastic has reached ocean, and now when this plastic floats on the surface of ocean, it reacts with the UV rays, UV rays of sun, and then it generates more harmful and smaller plastic that is known as microplastic. Now this microplastic is smaller in size, smaller than 5 mm, and such 51 trillion particles are right now floating on the ocean surface. See, microplastic is not a new term. It's already been used in our cosmetics and sometime in toothpaste also, right? It's there in our toothpaste and cosmetic, but now since it has been reaching through a cycle, from a waste, because it was a waste, then it went to the OB found in our water system also. So in the coming few years, we might be having a tap water full of microplastic. And obviously, this microplastic is causing harm for the marine life, no doubt in this. But the one thing which I want to address here is, see, apart from all this issue, we aren't able, problem of plastic is because if we look as energy base, like if we look at plastic and its alternative, for example, jute bag, cotton bag or khadi bag, jute or cotton bag. A plastic bag would require less amount of resources and less amount of energy in comparison of jute and cotton bag, right? Energy consumption in jute bag is high in comparison of plastic. So generally people will prefer producing plastic. So being a responsible consumer, it is my responsibility to set demand of certain products or certain alternative which should be taken right now, at least for a particular period of time. It's easy for us to throw away a 2 rupee pen or 10 rupee chips packet, but I'm sure we will be thinking twice or thrice before throwing 100 or 200 rupees thing, right? We don't easily throw away something that valuable, or at least 500 or let's be 150 rupees something. Because certain things are cheaper, we don't value them and we just throw them here and there. So this is also one reason I find. So let's do an activity. This is the time of first activity. I had already asked you to bring a notebook and a pencil. So now we will be listing out our plastic item which we generally use in our daily life. Okay, beginning from morning to night, whatever plastic thing you use in your daily life, make a list of it. We will be making three columns all together. First column, we will be listing out plastic item which we use in our daily life. In second column, we will be writing their alternatives. And then in third column, we will be writing how much time we required, you know, to shift to that alternative. So we can start right now, I think. I have a table. I have already made a table, but I want you to do it first, and then I will be showing you that how. Okay, I will show you. See, you can see this is a table which you have to make in your notebook. First, you will be listing plastic items. Like I have listed toothbrush, toothpaste, comb, shampoo pouches, carry bag, lunchbox, water bottle, cutlery, straw. And then in the second column, you can see I have just kept their alternative. Like for toothbrush, I have written wooden brush or neem stick. Okay, that can be an alternative of toothbrush. And how much time required? 1 week or 6 months. See, why I have written 6 months is because if you have recently bought a new toothbrush, I don't want you to throw that in the dustbin and get a new wooden toothbrush, because then it would, you know, cancel out and will be same. So one thing which we have to understand in this workshop is shifting to eco alternative doesn't mean that you have to throw away all your plastic already existing in your home to the dustbin, because then it will be all same, right? So we don't have to throw anything out, but we don't have to bring anything new. Right, we will be reusing and upcycling already existing plastic in our home or in our room. But something which have to be, like if I have to buy something new, I will try it has to be non-plastic. Okay, either it could be of steel, it could be of wooden, or I can borrow it from someone, even that would be fine. So why this activity is? Because this will be a starting point for you if you want to live a, you know, eco lifestyle or sustainable lifestyle, because you can find out that these are the items or these are the products which I am contributing as my footprint. These are my footprints over here, and next to them are my handprints. Like I'm doing something to preserve or conserve nature. So these are my handprints. So once I achieve all these handprints in this time, I will be, you know, moving towards sustainable lifestyle. So this is all activity, and this activity you all can do, right? Even I had started with this activity only in 2018. I had made this table, and then within 2 to 3 and 4 months, I simply started shifting towards this alternative. And then within a year, I was completely plastic free. Not completely, okay, 90% plastic free. Yes. So this will help you in maintaining, you know, how much you have achieved during all these days, if you will be practicing the sustainable lifestyle or zero waste or zero plastic lifestyle. All right. In case you have any queries regarding the alternative, you can put your queries or question in the, yeah. So I think you all understand this activity, right? And please remember the point which I said earlier, you don't have to buy anything new. If you already have recently bought something, it's okay, you can use it. Try to use it for longer time, because we have to achieve sustainability. Sustainability over here means that whatever we have as a resource, we have to use it for a longer period of time in a sustainable manner. So now, So since you have been shifted towards this eco alternative, you must be having a lot of plastic item in your room or at your home. Now, some of my upcycled. First of all, I started with the bottle which I had found in my home.
Garima,
So I
you are not audible. Hello. Hello, Garima, you're not audible. Please check
Hello?
your connection.
Hello?
Hello. Yeah, you're not audible. Can you please
Yeah.
check your internet
Hello?
connection? Hello.
Am
Your
I
voice
audible?
is breaking. Your voice
Okay.
is breaking.
Hello?
Hello, can you hear me?
Hello?
Hello, can you hear me?
Now is it
Hello,
audible?
can you hear me?
Yeah, I can
Yeah,
hear you.
okay. Yeah, okay.
Yeah.
Please continue, ma'am. Thank
Okay.
you.
Yeah, okay. Sorry for the interruption. Okay, so first I started, reusing all the plastic bottles I had in my rooms, and I had started planting these samplings. And the middle picture is of a self-watering system. So instead of watering, daily to a plant, I just did this self-watering system thing. In this, there is just a thread in the bottom, which is connected up to the root area, right? So that the plant would take up the water as per its requirement, and we just have to fill the bottle once. And similarly, I had this craft activity, which is known as crochet in northern part, and I used all the milk packets and plastic sheets I had in my home to make this mat and phone cover. And even for the older phone cover, I used my fabric to give them a new look. See, here the I didn't throw the older phone covers into the dustbin. Instead, I just gave them a new look. This we can try, right? This is the unnecessary item because most of the time we don't need it. We generally throw it. Instead, we can reuse it and give it a new look and then use it again, right? And then I had made few organizers with plastic bottles, some with the fabrics, stationery box. These all are the bottles, like in the middle picture you will be seeing that's a coconut oil bottle, right? And then in the right corner you will be seeing these are the fabrics. See, I'm very precise about reusing fabric at least, because the fabric and the fabric consumes a lot of water in its manufacturing. The highest water footprint is of denim jeans. It takes around 4,000 liters. That's the water footprint of a denim jeans. That much amount of water is been utilized in manufacturing just one pair of jeans, denim jeans. So that's why I make sure that I won't just throw it into dustbin. Either I will donate it to someone or swap it with my friend or something, or I will reuse it. And I had made this mat, I would call, or you can call it asana also, puja asana, or even you can use it as a doormat or just for sitting purpose also. And similarly, with again crochet, I had made this 5 feet long yoga mat, because I didn't want to use that plastic yoga mat. If you will be purchasing the new one, then there is no use of buying the new one. Instead, you can use this kind of mat for yoga purpose. And then with the crochet again, I had made these two bags. And the picture in lower left, the hair bands and these neck pieces, I have used Rita. Since I use Rita for my hair wash regular on regular basis, so I had used the Rita seed. because I didn't want to throw the Rita again into dustbin. So I used the Rita seeds and old fabric to make these hair bands, and these they can also be used as neck pieces and all. See, the main idea is to be creative and prevent waste, any kind of waste, to the dustbin. That's the basic idea, right? That's the basic idea. And when you have been shifted towards eco-alternative, and when you have been, you know, practicing upcycling and reusing stuff, still there is a separate kind of waste which is produced in our home, that is wet waste or kitchen waste. So for that, I had started doing composting at home. And that process is very simple. You just have to get a pot, you know, earthen pot, with few holes in the surface and at least three in the bottom, and then holder, slurry holder at the bottom, so that the compost slurry could be collected in that holder, in that container. Then you have to just keep your all biodegradable waste, your kitchen waste, your vegetable peels or your leftover food in that pot, then sprinkle some of the dry sand over it and cover it with the leaves. And similarly, fill your pot for one week or 2 weeks, it is completely filled. Then you can keep it in a corner, okay? And there won't be any smell if you will be properly covering it with the leaves regularly. Every time you add wet waste into that pot, remember to sprinkle the dry sand or dry soil and cover it with the leaves every time. Then once a week, we just have to stir it. Then within two months, you will be having a compost ready at your home. So instead of buying from outside, again, getting a, you know, material, a nature-oriented material like compost in a package of in a plastic packaging, it's better to, you know, try to make it at home and then use it at home. And eventually I went into this workshop of soap making also, because I didn't wanted to get those heavy bottles of shower gel and etc. So this was the most interesting activity which I found, because I have been very excited for using eco brick. Actually, the first three slides are of eco bricks, and the fourth picture, first three pictures are of eco bricks, and the fourth picture is of the item, the product, that is a stool, a footrest you can also say, or a stool. So I have used all these bottles to make that footrest. I also use it as a stool sometime at home. So we will also be learning how to make these bricks and what else we have to be careful about while making these bricks. And then we can also experiment at our home and construct anything we like with the help of these eco bricks. And these, in the end, during Diwali, we had this pista at home, and as obviously I didn't want to throw them into the dustbin, so I just reused them to make these coaster of diyas. And the diyas are also made up of cow dung, so to make that complete eco-friendly Diwali, I had made this coaster, and diya I had got from a market. There is a market in Ahmedabad. From there I got these diyas. So if you think that how one eco brick or just one attempt can change the picture or can change the whole surrounding or environment, then I will be showing you two more slides. They are short video clips of I think few seconds only, without any audio. There is no audio, they are just clips. So you can then picture that if all the waste would have been, you know, in these eco bricks, what would have been the scene or what would have been the scenario? So I will be playing these videos. See, all the waste is being lying. And this area is just outside our hostel. Now see what does the animal found animal finds in waste is they get confused with the smell, structure, and you know how the waste is being kept there. Most of the time you will see a cow eating from plastic bag, but in the end she will eat that bag also. Not just cow, tortoise, fishes, whale, every animal get confused because of all these waste getting mixed and then dumped at a place. That's why the segregation is important, right? Not only for ourselves, not only for environment or air pollution, but also for these animals. Segregation is important. See, so much of plastic just lying here and there, all mixed. This all could have been in a, you know, plastic bottle, and then that bottle could have been used for construction or for some other purpose, or just, you know, creating that pot like structure, and for plantation also they can be used, eco bricks. So much these are the unnecessary single use plastic. So now let's move on to activity 2, that is eco brick. You all must be having a bottle, some of the plastics, and a long brush or any stick or screwdriver or something, just to push that plastic into the bottom. See, what we have to be careful about, the plastic should be dry, okay, and clean. So suppose you are using milk packet, they should be clean and dry, because we will be keeping all this plastic in a container for a longer period of time now. So there shouldn't be any kind of some other thing rather than just plastic. So all non-biodegradable plastic, the plastic which is not biodegradable, all that plastic should go inside these eco bricks, Plastostone also, some places it is also known as Plastostone. The application you can see on your right, they have been using in construction purposes, and as I have also used at my home to make that stool. See, there are mainly 7 type of plastic, right? If you must be having a wrapper or something, you can also see even on a wrapper of a biscuit, like I'm having a wrapper of a biscuit and there is a number 7 on it. If you all are having plastic waste, then you can also check the number on that waste. There must be this symbol. You must be seeing this symbol, na? The 3 lines in this triangular form. And then there is these number 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. So the number, it actually tells about plastic resin. What kind of plastic resin is being used in its manufacturing? Or basically, it's a recycling number. That is, higher the number, more time it will take to get recycled. Why? Because the plastic having higher number, the plastic with number 7. Is not one kind of plastic. There have been more than 2 plastic which were used during its manufacturing. So for the number 7, if you can see in the picture, the big jar cans, they are not of one kind of plastic, right? They have more than one kind of plastic in their structure. So that's why it is very tough to recycle these kind of plastic. So we should avoid getting at least 7, 6 and 5 or 4, even 4 also. We should avoid getting these plastic because they are tough to recycle. Plastic gets only recycled if it reaches the recycling center. In the earlier slide, you had seen video. Now all the plastic was lying on the ground, right? It isn't a dump fill or that site, but still the plastic is lying there because it wasn't able to reach the recycling center. So plastic will only get recycled when it reaches the recycling center, unless it will just lie around here and there. It will reach from this place to that place and end up in the ocean. Every plastic will end up in the ocean bed only. So we just have to make sure that nothing from my home or from my dustbin goes to the ocean bed or goes to the river or even to my dump yard. So we just have to be careful about this. And now if we will be making an, you know, eco brick, so we can try to accumulate or we can try to put one kind of plastic in single bottle. Suppose I am having a bottle, I will try to put only one number of plastic in that. In second bottle, I will be putting the second number of plastic. In wrappers also, this number is given, not just in bottles or all these, you know, the items which have been showed in the slides. See, each plastic is of different kind, having different quality, right? So that's why the recycling procedure or recycling mechanism is also different for different plastic. But imagine a country like India where segregation itself is, you know, impossible. Mostly impossible segregation of mixed waste. So in such a country, in such a scenario, how can we segregate these kinds of plastic? Even within the waste, we have to segregate the type of plastic waste. So this is really difficult. That's why the segregation at the source itself is feasible. That should be done. So now you know, so now let me just stop sharing my screen and we will be making the eco brick. For now, I will be stopping the screen, okay? I will come back to the, I will again share the screen because I have to show you the application part also. See. I have been already making this eco brick, okay? So it's completely filled right now, you all can see, but still there is some space. So with the long brush or stick or something, I'm using this brush, you have to push it. Now I will be just folding this plastic. Yeah. It though seems it's full, but it isn't full. I can still feed something to it. And once it is full, you will see the difference. See, this is easily compressible and it's hard. It's heavy also. This is obviously light, right? And we have to keep filling our, you know, eco brick or this plastic bottle unless it is full. Right now I am using the mixed plastic. I haven't segregated it because I want to make something at my room itself. See, the plastic having plastic of one type will be used for something which is having low flexibility or which is low in quality, because if it has plastic of number one, then the quality will be low of that whole plastic, right? And then the plastic having number seven, for example, this plastic, see, it has number seven. If it is visible over here, it has number seven. It isn't easily recyclable because, see, over here it's plastic and aluminium is also there. Yeah, this is the mixed plastic, so this isn't easily recyclable. So if all seven number kind of plastic will get into one bottle, that bottle will have similar same kind of property which can be used to build something much stronger like that, right? So now you can make an eco brick at your home and at your place. Seems full, but still you can push with the brush and fill more inside it. Still there is some space, so you have to, yeah, you can try it your own. still there is space. Still, I can, you know, put some two or three more plastic bag inside this. So if you will perform this activity at your home, you will see that in a small bottle, you can actually accumulate your whole 1 week or even 1 month plastic waste. Just you have to keep pressing the plastic waste, and you have to be just make sure that your waste is, you know, completely dry. For example, these milk packets, all the plastic waste I have collected from all my neighboring friends from in hostel, because I don't have any plastic at my place itself. So you have to make sure that these are dry, right? And then just fold them. And then again press it. Even now I can fit one more plastic inside this. So once your bottle is filled, you can just close the lid and your eco brick is ready. My eco brick is ready. If you have eco bricks at your home, you have eco brick collector at in your near around places, you can go to them, you can collect all your eco bricks and give to them. Or if you want to do something at your place, you can use all these eco bricks and make something at your place also. See, many people are working in the waste management sector, so I am listing few of the yes these are few of the NGOs which are working in plastic waste management. EFI, the Environmentalist Foundation of India, Project Surat, it's in Gujarat, Paryavaran Sanrakshan. So Environmentalist Foundation of India, they've been doing extremely great work in lake regeneration. They are cleaning the lake, and they have also started, you know, collecting these eco bricks, and they call it plastostone also. So in case if you make all these plastostone at your place, in your college or in your university, in your hostel, you can collect them, and then you can contact EFI and they will collect them from you. Or you can also contact, if you are from northern part of India, you can contact Project Surat or Paryavaran Sanrakshan. They also collect these eco bricks. Project Surat is being working specifically for, you know, oceans and beaches. They have been working in this field amazingly. Then Paryavaran Sanrakshan, they started with this 5-star So this was all. So in case you have any queries or question, okay, I will see in the message box.
So this was a great session. Am I audible?
Yeah.
Am I audible, Garima?
Yes. Yes, I can hear you.
Yeah. So it was a great session, Garima. Participants, as of now, they don't have any queries. The participants, if you have any further queries, you can either unmute or post your queries in the chat box. Until then, can I ask you questions, Garima?
Yeah.
So we already have so many tons of plastics, as you have mentioned at the beginning. So what can we do for that much of plastic? Now, eco brick, one thing, what else can we do?
See, the waste which is already been collected in the landfill or that area, that cannot be segregated for right now. Like right now we cannot segregate or work on that waste, but from our home we can start. At least we can try or prevent waste from getting into dustbin for the very first place, so that it won't lead to that landfill again. We won't be adding more into that landfill or that site. For the waste which will be coming in your room or in your home, for that we can shift to the economy, so that waste won't be generated at very first place. In case it is generated, try to segregate it and make sure the recyclable waste goes to the center itself. There are few, I know the center are quite few, but make sure that it goes to a recycling center only, and the wet one can be, you know, used at home to make compost. Only we will be left with the hazardous waste, that is our sanitary napkin, blades, or something like that. You know, at home generally these are the hazardous waste at home. So they generally go for incineration. Even in the municipal site also, these waste are incinerated, the hazardous waste, hazardous waste, or they are, you know, dug, they are buried down into the ground. Generally for hazardous waste, this is the management.
Okay, Garima, thank you very much. Any other participants have questions? Hello? All right. So I will be posting the feedback link in the chat box. I request all the participants to fill the chat feedback link. And also, Garima, thank you for this very great session. We will all try to learn and practice this in our homes. And I hope all the participants who have attended this session would have been encouraged to be such environmentalists in the near future. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Just remember one thing. We have to just define our purpose, right? If you know the purpose of thing you are using in your life, you will be easily, you know, working on that, and you can easily categorize whether you need that thing in your life or not. Then you can switch to the, you can either avoid it or you can switch to its alternative. Thank you.